This is a WBAL News Radio Town Hall. Youth Violence. Here are your hosts, C4 and Brian Neiman, on WBAL News Radio 1090 FM 101.5 and the WBAL radio app.
In the last couple of months in this city, we have seen a 10-year-old girl walk into a store being shot in the chest because of an alleged gang dispute between teenagers, stray bullet. She walks around today, fortunately she's alive, with that bullet in her chest. We had a 12-year-old shot in the arm from another alleged gang dispute, that he, fortunately, is here with us. We had two 16-year-olds and a 13-year-old carjack a 41-year-old man on his way to work, run him over with his own car, and kill him. Whether teenagers or youth are the perpetrators, Brian Neiman, or the victims, we have had a youth violence explosion in this city since the riots following the death of Freddie Gray in April of 2015. In 2018, July, an organization that for 30 years in the state of Massachusetts had been resolving disputes out in the streets in different cities in Massachusetts, working with the hardest to work with when it comes to 16 to 24-year-olds, and they were brought to Baltimore to try to engage. Joining us right now, and I've talked to them before, is Kurtis Palermo. He's the director of ROCA Baltimore. And James Timpson, he's the director of safety and community partnerships with ROCA Baltimore. Kurtis and JT, good morning to you.
Gentlemen, good morning.
Good morning. How are you?
Good morning. Good morning.
Doing great. Let me start with you, Kurtis Palermo. Once again, the director of ROCA Baltimore. You've been on the ground since the beginning. I laid out a few examples of what we have been watching just this year, but whether it's carjackings, whether it's gang involvement, you work with the hardest young people to reach, that 16, 24 age group. What are you finding out here in the streets as you go around, Kurtis Palermo?
You know, it's interesting, and it's important to remember, you know, we're working with these young men who are 16 to 24, and they're at the highest risk to either be incarcerated long-term or die by homicide. And that approach takes a behavioral health lens, and it's a long-term approach. So, you know, with these young individuals who are, whether being the perpetrators or the victims of these crimes, you know, that intervention, it's not about a job, it's not about education. It really is about behavior change, and that takes time. And the level of violence has been unprecedented, and it's unacceptable, and there are so many people being shot and killed in the city of Baltimore that, you know, this approach has to be done very strategically, but it's important that, you know, these young people we work with or these young people who are perpetrating these crimes are in a different bucket than those for prevention or pre-intervention. We are working with those young people who, like I said, are most likely to be dead or in jail if something does not dramatically change in their lives.
Well, James, can you tell us, I mean, it feels like it's worse now than it was 6 years ago or 10 years ago. Is that the case right now? I mean, are we in a real dangerous spot here in Baltimore with our youth?
Sure, absolutely. The culture has shifted. So if you look at the culture of violence or the landscape of violence that we're seeing across the city right now, it's not the same. It's not historically the same that it's been. And because of that, it does make it, it does give it a feel like things are a lot more volatile than I've seen in my lifetime. And it's really because of the shift in the culture on the streets. You have less guidance, you have, you know, less people willing to engage. You know, you don't really have the existence of a street code anymore. So with that being gone, it's like a lot of young people are left to really kind of just follow their instincts, which is why what Kurtis said was so important about the behavior change. We got to focus on changing their behaviors and what they have normalized. They have normalized so many things that are abnormal.
We're talking with ROCA Baltimore representatives. We are having a town hall on youth violence. We'll be joined after the 9:30 news by former Maryland State Senator Bobby Zirkin from Baltimore County. He initiated a juvenile justice reform council at the state level. It's meeting the last 2 years to try to come up with some answers. And State's Attorney Scott Shellenberger from Baltimore County will join us at about 9:45. Let me go back to you, JT, James Timpson, Director of Safety and Community Partnerships with ROCA Baltimore. Look, when I was coming up, JT, you know, we didn't have the Crips and Bloods. We had street name gangs or something like that, but nothing this organized. How pervasive is the gang element of this? Because many people believe it's the gang draw, particularly with that 16 to 24-year-old group.
It's the same. It's all about neighborhoods. These gangs aren't structured. Like, it's no difference in the structure of the gangs here that than it was back in the day. It's just that people have created a false perception of this big gang problem in Baltimore. Baltimore's a city of neighborhoods, not a city of gangs. We're a city of neighborhoods. And that is the way that the structure remains. So you could be whatever you want to be wherever you are, but once you go back into your neighborhood, you're going to identify with what people in your neighborhood say that they are. So it's the same. The structure is just not there for your large gangs. Like, you think about your Bloods and Crips and all those type of things. You may have some small structured pockets in the city, but that's not the pervasive issue. You know, the pervasive issue is still the condition of the neighborhoods and what these young people have to leave out their front door and see and what they have to return to at home every night. So it's bigger than that. It's much bigger than that. It's still a city of neighborhoods, and people identify with what is popular in their neighborhood.
Fascinating. We're talking with James Tipson and Kurtis Palermo of ROCA Baltimore. So Kurtis, what do you do? I mean, walk us through how you try to get kids on the straight and narrow and how to help them, not get into a life where they're going to either wind up in bars, as you said, or shooting someone or shot themselves.
I mean, it all starts with, you know, the brain science and addressing the trauma that these young people have been through or are still going through, because, you know, they're living in this survival mode, right? They have a constant fear that won't turn off, and they think everyone and everything is out to get them. So their natural reaction in these situations is fight, flight, or freeze. And most of the time for these young men, it's fight. You know, they genuinely feel like they shot someone, because if they didn't, they might be the one shot or dead. And it really takes, like I said, a long-term approach using cognitive behavioral theory, helping them understand that their thoughts, their feelings, their actions are three very different things, but one will impact the other two. So using these skills in real time with these young people, you know, on the street level with frontline staff, in a classroom with an educator, whether they're on one of our work crews in the transitional employment program, just constantly wrapping around and the follow-up, because we're very clear with them. Look, you've been doing this for 16 to 24 years, and quite frankly, you're lucky to be alive. But this is an opportunity for you to now change the trajectory of your life. And we cannot save these young people. We cannot make decisions for them. They have to invest the time, and they have to do it. And if they do, we have seen successes in Baltimore. We're, you know, very close to 3 years. Obviously, the pandemic shifted our operations. We were still in the community. We were still engaging with these young people. But we have young men who are working. We have young men who have, you know, worked through their trauma, have, you know, dealt with domestic violence, substance abuse. They're seeing a clinician. They're much better off than they would have been without the intervention from ROCA. But they understand that they still have more work to do. And just being honest with them and holding them accountable is so critical, because if we don't, it's very easy for them to go back to that survival mode and react instead of actually considering the consequences of what they're doing.
JT, you're the former site director for the Park Heights Safe Streets program. And I remember that Safe Streets went, in that particular Park Heights program, went an entire year without one homicide, similar to what we saw in Cherry Hill with the Safe Streets program. From that experience, JT, what do you bring from that to ROCA to try to be a violence interrupter with many of these young men, 16 to 24?
The key to our success there in Park Heights with Safe Streets was really our relationships with the young people and the relationships with the community. And that's the same approach we take here. Our relationships with the young people are extremely important, because we know that people change in context of relationships. So we have to have strong relationships with these young people. We have to show up. We have to continue to be relentless, because they're used to people failing. They're used to being failed by the system. They're used to being failed by everybody around them. We have to be a consistent presence and a consistent force in their life to let them know that you can do something different. Like Kurtis said, you just really have to apply yourself, and we'll walk the journey with you. We'll take that journey with you. People talk about hand-holding and all this type of stuff. Yes, they need to be hand-held, because they have been robbed of opportunities for so much of their lives. So if not us, then who? So we walk that journey with them, and we really build strong relationships with them that are strong enough to hold us being able to challenge them on their negative behaviors and really challenge them on changing things. And we show them how it looks, how the other side looks. So we were successful in Park Heights really because of our relationships. And that's the same thing that we one of our biggest focuses here with ROCA is really about the relationships and the relentless nature of the outreach and follow up with these young people. And they don't like it all the time because we show up at times where we're not invited all the time. But that's okay, because our job is to make sure that we stay present and that they know that we're present. And so we don't always ask permission. You know, we show up and we do what we do. And, you know, they're better off for it. So, and we understand that. And they eventually get to that point where they understand it as well.
Well, you've obviously had success. I am curious as to what could be helpful to you from government, from schools, from private sector to try and, you know, continue this and to get kids into the right frame of mind, as you put it, Kurtis.
Yeah, I mean, our approach and what we do at ROCA is kind of two part, and one is that frontline work, you know, with the young people and their behavior change journey. And then the other piece is the engaged institutions. So, you know, how can we impact systems level change? And some of the ways that we've been doing that is with a, you know, Baltimore cross intervention team, and that comprised of ROCA, Department of Juvenile Services, Department of Parole and Probation, the State's Attorney's Office, Baltimore Police Department, you know, whoever we can get at that level of, you know, decision making. For some of these things that do impact these young people. And even coming out of that, you know, training DJS in cognitive behavioral theory, talking about young adult caseloads for parole and probation and how that looks, or, you know, the after shooting protocol that we've developed, which is a real time response to a shooting incident in the city for anyone who's 16 to 24 years old and is a male. And that's a door knock, you know, 24 to 48 hours after someone is shot, we are going to their house. We're engaging with them, with their family. If they're in the hospital, we're reaching out to those individuals at Hopkins, at, you know, shock trauma, wherever they may be. So that work needs to continue because there's so much more to be done, and there's so much more that can be done outside of just 16 to 24-year-old young men that ROCA serves, because there are females being shot. There are, you know, individuals under 16, over 24 who need services, and, you know, ROCA can't do it all, but we're a small part of the bigger picture. So, you know, any way that we can continue that work with the B-Cross team, with the young adult brain science group that we've brought together, and just really focus on what's happening and, you know, forget about what speculation we might have. No, people are being shot and killed, and this is what we can do today to impact that. Not in 12 months from now, not do a bunch of research and look at a bunch of data, which is all well and good, but it's not helping the individuals today, right in this exact moment, that have been shot or might shoot someone in the next 24, 48 hours. And that's what's important, is what can we do now to help reduce the violence and save these individuals' lives, whether they're 16 to 24, outside of the age range, female, whatever it is.
We're talking with ROCA Baltimore. You just heard from Kurtis Palermo and James J.T. Timpson are on board with us, Representative ROCA, on our town hall on youth violence. And JT, you know, I work with young people. I used to work with 14 and 21-year-old dropouts. So I'm all for redemption and trying to work with young people to get them on the straight and narrow, as you do on a regular basis. But if you're the family of that 41-year-old man who was headed to work, who was killed and run over by his own car, or a mother who's trying to get into a car last year with a baby who had a gun put to her head by a youth and her car taken, or any of these other incidences, How do we say not to have consequences for these young people that do these things, JT?
So it's not about not delivering consequences. That's not helpful. People getting away with things is not helpful. It is not helpful not delivering consequences. What's helpful is delivering the right consequences. And when consequences are delivered, making sure that they have the services to help, again, change that behavior, right? So it's more because in the process of perpetrating, what you have to understand is the majority of the time that young person is perpetrating is also a victim or has been victimized at some point throughout their life. They are highly traumatized. They are highly traumatized young people. They need support. They need supportive adults in their lives and supportive programs to really help them make better decisions. Again, it's about behavior change. So I would never advocate for no consequences. I would advocate for consequences with proper support and proper services to go along with it to help with that behavior change process. So, you know, we understand that when young people do things, they have to answer for it. And we're very transparent and very upfront with them about that. Look, if you break the law, you have to answer to the law. We're not here to cover up for that or to sugarcoat that or to make it seem like you don't have to answer to that, because you do. What we are here to do is help you not make that bad decision again. And if it costs you, you know, some time, then we'll stick with you. We'll stick with you through the process and really help you get to the other side so that we aren't in this situation anymore. So we know it's going to happen, but we have to be prepared to deal with it and prepared to really work with these young people and not treat them as if they are castaways or they are on the outside margins of society. We have to pull them in, keep them close, and really focus on helping them change that behavior.
It almost sounds like it's like an addiction, like you treat people who have an addiction to drugs. Like it has to be them that wants to make the change. Am I wrong about that, Kurtis? And that's a tough way to look at it. But I mean, it does seem like you have to do that. The people have to convince themselves that it's the right decision for them to do in order to get on to the right path.
Yeah, you're exactly right, and it looks so different for each young person. And that's another important piece to realize is, you know, if we have two different young people, they've been through different experiences, they have different levels of trauma, whatever, risk level they're at, one may never work and, he may never come to ROCA for classes, all the time regularly, but he's, gone to see a therapist. He's, built a bridge in his family where relationships might have been torn, while the other, does work and does very well and, gets a trade, whatever it is, but everyone has to be, serviced individually for what is best for that young person. And that's what's so important is, the medicine is the same with the cognitive behavioral theory, with the wraparound, with the support, transformational relationships, the relentless outreach and follow-up, but it looks very different for each young person's process and their change. And that's how we support staff, because it's not easy working with this group of young people. And it's even harder when you feel like, it's been 12 months and Kurt hasn't done this, but it's okay, because it might take Kurt 18 months. It may take him 24 months, but we'll be there for him when he's ready to make that change. And like JT said, if something does happen, we're not just going to say, okay, we're going to wash our hands of the young person. We're going to support them. We'll go to see them if they are detained. We'll write them letters. We'll talk to their probation agent, their lawyer, their family, whoever we can, because that's what the support looks like. And it's fully wraparound. It takes time to change. If you are, quote unquote, a not so traumatized, well put together person, change takes time. You're not just going to wake up one day and say, all of these things in my life are going to change. It takes time.
Kurtis Palermo, director of ROCA Baltimore, and James Timpson, JT, director of safety and community partnerships, ROCA Baltimore. Please continue the work that you're doing. It is so important, and God bless you both.
Great to have you guys on.
Thank you. Thank you so much. We appreciate the time.
Brian, real quick, these type of programs aren't quick. They don't show immediate results. But if you go to ROCA Baltimore, everyone, online, you will see specifically the lives that this organization in 3 years has actually begun to change. And the question is, how do we replicate this, Brian?
Yeah, more of it. And also, maybe getting it before kids get to that age,
yep,
too. Getting them younger is a big key to that. Coming up, as we continue the town hall on youth violence, former lawmaker, attorney Bobby Zirkin, who's now chairman of the State Senate Judicial Proceedings Committee, that has been basically charged to look into this and figure out ways on why we are seeing a rise in youth violence right now. He's on the way next here on WBAL.
The WBAL News Radio Town Hall, Youth Violence Continues. WBAL News Radio 1090, FM 101.5, and the WBAL radio app.
Well, we just had a fascinating conversation with two gentlemen who are trying to make a difference and are making a difference in Baltimore when it comes to youth violence with the ROCA Baltimore. But let's look at it from a different angle now as we continue our town hall on youth violence, juvenile crime here in Baltimore, and not just in the city, but throughout the Baltimore area. Pleased to be joined now by our old friend, Bobby Zirkin, attorney, but former lawmaker, former chairman of the Maryland State Senate Judicial Proceedings Committee. Great to have you on.
Hey.
Appreciate you coming on the show. Good to talk to you again.
Hey, good to talk to you guys. Good to talk to you. I'd like to say I'm a reformed politician.
Completely understandable.
You can't have my job. I'm just telling you that.
So let me ask you just from the big macro point of view on where you see Baltimore today, and not just Baltimore, but, you know, the surrounding counties with youth violence in particular. Where are we today, Bobby?
I mean, it's obviously really challenging. There's a, you know, there are a lot of issues. I mean, and there have been for a long time. I remember, I mean, God, when I first got elected and was serving on the House Judiciary Committee, I mean, this is like 20 some odd years ago. I mean, the issues were actually even more significant. I mean, in addition to the violence that you saw with the youth, you had a system that had, you know, was essentially warehousing the kids and churning out better criminals. I mean, you had places like Hickey and Cheltenham and so forth that had, they didn't have 40, 50, 60 kids. They had hundreds of kids and they were just coming in and out. The recidivism rate was, you know, I mean, I can't remember, it's a long time ago, but it was pretty close to 100%. I mean, you basically were putting kids into a system, they'd come out and the chances that they were getting reformed were almost zero. And so, you know, we have come a long way in the last couple of decades. There's obviously still a lot of challenges to do, a lot of challenges to tackle. I mean, it's a hard, hard system. I mean, there are issues of poverty and education and, you know, there's a lot of things that go into it. The system is much better than it was 20 years ago, but still a long way to go.
We'll speak with former Maryland State Senator Bobby Zirkin. He now heads up the law firm of Zirkin and Schmerling. And one of the things we talked about in real time when you were still head of Mayo Committee, Judicial Proceedings Committee, Bobby Zirkin, and that was the Juvenile Justice Reform Council, that in the aftermath of the horrible murder of Baltimore County Police Officer Amy Caprio and the recognition that our juvenile justice system was really broken in so many ways, they put this council together. Talk about this, and it's been a couple of years they put this. I know you're not there anymore, but the necessity of doing something like this to review how we do what we do.
So, yeah, I mean, and that's been, you know, that was kind of the latest council. There were a bunch of them over the years, and that was spearheaded by the now Senate President, Bill Ferguson. Like, he was very... insistent on putting together this council, and I thought it was a great idea. Look, at the end of the day, you have to constantly be reviewing what's going on in that system. I mean, if you think about it, you get a kid that's 12 or 13 or whatever that gets themselves in trouble at some low level. The question is, well, what do you do with them? If the answer is you just kind of, you know, smack them on the wrist and put them back out in the community, they learn nothing. And if you don't have services in that community, then they really learn nothing. And then the next one's going to be a little worse. The next one's going to be a little worse. The next thing you know, they're doing hard, you know, they're doing much more significant crimes. And so the question is, well, what do you do with them when they're 12? Because when they're 17 and doing carjacks or, you know, or armed robbery or, you know, all kinds of things, you've lost them. I mean, you've got to get these kids at the earliest possible point when problems are starting, and that's not necessarily what we do particularly well. At the beginning, you know, again, when I first got in and when you were there, C4, we didn't do anything well. You didn't do that.
Yep.
And the kids that you had in the system who were more hardened, you know, had already been through the system multiple times, we did that terribly too, right? You put them into these monstrous facilities back then and churn them out as really good criminals.
It's like graduate school for
them. You graduated as a better criminal back then. And there was a turning point on that. I mean, look, it's not perfect. You're going to have this is criminal. You know, this is crime. Like, getting it down to zero is going to be is impossible. Nobody's figured that one out yet. But back then, you know, with the way it was versus the way the system is now, it definitely is better now. I mean, I don't know if you remember this, C4, because I definitely was on your show talking to you about this when this all occurred. A bunch of us went, I think it was during the Ehrlich administration, with Ken Montague and Carmen Amadori, Tony O'Donnell and others. We went out to the state of Missouri, of all places. Missouri had what was widely known to be the best system in the country, mm-hmm. in terms of what they did with kids in the system, you know, when kids were confined after committing juvenile offenses. And it wasn't, once you went out there and you saw the difference between what Maryland was doing and what Missouri was doing, it wasn't hard to see why they were so good. they didn't have 400 kids in a facility kind of just roaming around doing nothing. They had 30, 20, 30, 40 kids tops in a facility. There was an adult for every kid. They had high-level social workers and counselors and mentors. I mean, it was just like they were working overtime to really reform the kids. And they got them at an early stage, and they had very few. I mean, I went to a facility out there in Jefferson City that had like 12 kids. That was it. And you had, you know, it was like 12 kids and 20 adults there that were just working with them and educating them, getting them athletic. I mean, that's the way you do juvenile justice. When you get the kid in the system, you target those kids with tremendous resources, and it's not that expensive. It's significantly less expensive to do that versus what comes next. When you let kids out and they commit crimes, the expense of that is so much more than what it would take to get these kids back on track. And so,
I just want to say that because I think to your point about, you know, once the carjacking starts, it's really hard to turn it around, and that makes sense. So if we did focus more on getting them at a younger age, at what age do you start, and who does that, or is that just a part of the process or the community? Like, is there a specific thing or program that could be put out there either by the city or by the state to try and prevent those 10-year-olds or 12-year-olds from turning into carjackers when they're 14, 15, 16 years old?
The answer to that is yes. I do think it is incumbent on the state to do it, obviously, with, you know, in partnership with the localities. But there's no one magic program. It depends on what the kids are doing. It depends on, you know, if the kids are into drugs at a young age, you need to get them treatment immediately. If they're selling drugs, I mean, it's such a good question, but it's a multifaceted answer. Like, it's hard to boil that answer down into a couple sentences. You want to get these kids the help they need at the earliest possible, you know, you want to get involved at the earliest possible time. And there's unfortunately kind of this movement to not do that, to not, quote, get the kids into the system. You're not trying to get these kids into the system for purposes of getting them in trouble. You want to get them into the system for purposes of getting them support. And so you have to build up the type of communities where I think you guys were talking to ROCA before, like that type of program is the type of thing that you need to see significantly more of, more resources for that. And this is not throwing money at the problem. This is, there are proven methods of interventions for the younger kids. You have to try to get, for example, the family involved. And there's law on the books about that. Like, we passed all these laws back in the day to try to turn our system to doing things like what you guys are talking about today, to try to get the 12-year-old who gets in trouble the interventions they need on a consistent basis. But unfortunately, what ends up happening, a lot of these kids fall through the cracks, and you find them again the next time they commit a crime, which are increasingly more significant than the first one.
You're listening. I'm sorry. Go ahead, Senator.
No, that's it. Sorry for the long-winded answer.
But it's important because where we're trying to head to, you're listening to a town hall on youth violence. That's former Maryland State Senator Bobby Zirkin on board with us. And Senator Zirkin, in about a minute that we have with you, you know, I asked ROCA Baltimore about consequences. And going back to the Baltimore County officer, her tragic murder, Amy Caprio, you had a mother begging the system when her 16-year-old had four felony auto thefts, and yet he was put back on the street, and the system didn't intervene. What about consequences when young people are showing this type of behavior, Senator?
Yeah, that's the other failure of the system. When the kids are first exhibiting this type of behavior, you want to get them the services they need to try to really work hard to get them not to go beyond. When they continue and continue and continue and continue, there has to be consequences. There have to be services along the way. You try to get them back on track. But at the end of the day, you know, when people do hardened crimes, then they should do hardened time for that, right? Like, I am certainly never was and never will be one of these people that says, well, they're, you know, if they're under the age of 18 and they commit murder, you know, they're just kids, you know, doing kid things. That to me is kind of outrageous. So, like, you know, at the end of the day, you do the best you can. The problem, that the failure has been to stopping the kids from getting to that point. And that's right, where the state can really focus their and should be focusing their attention. Again, small facilities, mentors. I mean, there's a law on the books right now signed with great fanfare with Governor Ehrlich and Ken Montague, the secretary at the time, that demands that the department give mentors for every kid in the system. Problem is, it got amended to say best efforts to do that, and apparently the best efforts are zero.
Yeah, we know what that means.
Has not happened. But can you imagine, for example, a kid who's 12 years old, who's just starting to exhibit juvenile problems, getting a mentor like a Torrey Smith or somebody like that to work with that kid? How much of an impact that would have on that kid to try to keep the kid from committing juvenile, more serious offenses? Like, that small intervention would have a huge impact. When you get that kid that you're talking about that's done armed, carjacking or armed robbery multiple times, you have lost that fight. I mean, you have failed the kid at the earliest possible, and it's almost too late. I mean, you can try, but that's a crime and punishment issue now, not something that the state can, kind of come in with services and fix. I mean, it just, you've kind of lost the kid, and that's a failure of the state.
Thank you so much. Once again, former Maryland State Senator Bobby Zirkin, his law firm now Zirkin and Schmerling. And I know you're never going to leave the issue of youth alone, so I appreciate your time, Senator.
Thank you, Bobby. Appreciate it.
Thanks for doing this, guys. Take care. Good talking to you.
Coming up, a discussion with Baltimore County State's Attorney Scott Shellenberger about where we go when it comes to juveniles and crime.
Now more of the WBAL News Radio Town Hall on Youth Violence. Here again are C4 and Brian Neiman on WBAL News Radio 1090, FM 101.5, and the WBAL radio app.
You're listening to a town hall on youth violence in our Baltimore area. On board with us now is Baltimore County State's Attorney Scott Shellenberger. Good morning, State's Attorney.
Good morning, sir.
Hey, C4. Hi, Brian. How are you all doing?
I'm doing well, thanks.
I'm doing great. Look, you were a part of the Juvenile Justice Reform Council that was legislatively created, and you've dealt with many high-profile situations with juveniles. And one of the things I'm concerned about, I think a lot of people are, is in this wave to try to, remove consequences from juveniles, we're not doing them any favors. Nobody wants to lock up kids forever, but when you do crimes, you can't just swipe that away, State's Attorney.
You're absolutely right, and that's my dilemma. I don't know if I'm the best representative of the Juvenile Justice Reform Council, but my friend Senator Zirkin really hit the nail on the head, and that is we need to offer these services to the juveniles when they're committing these smaller crimes at a younger age. You know, he's talking about getting them in treatment when they're 12. We may have to go earlier than that, and there is usually an indication, because once it comes up to the level of the four individuals who are responsible for the death of poor Amy Caprio, once it gets to that level, then I don't have a choice. I have to protect the public. So the answer is getting the services and the proper treatment at an earlier age so that when they are 17, when they are 16, they aren't killing a police officer.
So how do you do that? Like, I mean, I know that's not your job per se, but I mean, like, how does that happen? How could it actually begin that process?
Well, I mean, it partly is my job because I have an entire juvenile unit dedicated to prosecuting juvenile offenders. We have a statewide juvenile justice agency that is charged with doing this. But we definitely need to offer stronger and better services at an earlier age. And that's what the Juvenile Justice Reform Council was talking about this year. Even if you put a juvenile in detention, you can't just have them sit there. You need to offer some counseling, education, drug and alcohol treatment if they need it, and health services. All those things need to be done. Some of the things we've been taking a look at is that, removing them from their community, taking them away from their families, isn't always the best thing to do. But again, I'm not talking about by the time they get to killing Amy Caprio. I'm talking about earlier, well before they need to be offered these kind of services. And that is one of the factors and things that the Juvenile Justice Council is working on that I do agree with. We need to actually do better at the beginning.
State's Attorney from Baltimore County, Scott Shellenberger, is on board with us. And State's Attorney, how do we convince people who are hearing, you know, at times we need to remove juveniles from society, that we're looking out for public safety, that public safety and the rest of us have to be as important as that juvenile?
Oh, absolutely. And frankly, that is more important to me than anything. And that's why, you know, I'm in a difficult role, because I can only look at it in terms of public safety. If you have a person, or what people want to call a child, but I call an adolescent, if they're posing a danger to society and you can't offer the right kind of treatment to assure me that the public will be safe, then I have no choice and don't want another choice but to protect the public the way I know how to, and that is by sentencing the person to jail. And that's just a simple reality, because the example that we all cite, every one of the people involved in the death of Amy Caprio were juveniles, and every one of them were breaking into houses in Baltimore County, and certainly the person, Dante Harris, who killed Amy Caprio, he had prior contacts, and people were trying to offer the things that they could. And then once he committed that crime in Baltimore County, there was no choice. They have to be punished, and they have to be appropriately punished.
We've talked a lot in this entire hour, and we haven't mentioned family. You brought up briefly there for a second ago. I'm curious as to what it is like in the family unit. You talked about maybe sometimes taken away. I know that the one of the kids charged in the death of Amy Caprio, his mom was begging for help. But what role are these families playing in their kids' lives? Because ultimately, they are kids, right? They're supposed to have people around them that guide them in the right way.
Well, respectfully, Brian, when you're 17 and you killed a police officer, Maryland law says you're an adult.
I'm talking about carjackings at 13. I mean, we've seen that in the city recently. I mean, they're younger than 17. They're committing these crimes.
I got you. You know, maybe their age is what it says it is, but you know, the crimes they are committing are very adult crimes. And let me tell you, there is often nothing more dangerous and scary than being pulled out of your own car. And that's certainly something, a carjacking is a very dangerous thing. But you're right. You know, a lot of these youth, they don't have strong families. And so the question then is, can our juvenile justice system, you know, build in the services that they need to kind of take the place of the families that haven't been supporting them? But you're right. In the case of Dante Harris, who's responsible for the death of Officer Caprio, his mother was literally begging the system to help her son. And unfortunately,
they failed. We got to leave it there. Baltimore County State's Attorney Scott Shellenberger. This is just the beginning, everyone, of a discussion we're going to have on youth violence in our town hall. Thank you so much.
Great to have you on.
Thank you for having me. Good luck today.
This is a WBAL News Radio Town Hall special, Youth Violence. This is WBAL News Radio 1090 FM 101.5 and the WBAL radio app.
Well, another good hour in the books regarding our town hall.
A lot of work to do, Brian.
But yes, it's not going to be solved anytime soon, unfortunately. But we'll stay on it.
Thank you, Jacob.